that's about causes. Then there was several sources for low accuracy spatial data. And some of them are the malfunction of devices. The GPS doesn't work. It gives wrong couple of coordinates. But it can also be due to wrong interpretation when transforming the coordinates between systems or when geo-referencing urban locality. And it also can happen that some kind of issue when digitizing the data appears. Well, we will focus on the last two, because the first one we'll do a little thing about. So, transformations, changing the coordinates from one system to another, geo-referencing locality. It's transformations in general are prone to errors if are not handled carefully. Why? Because these transformations can go from very simple conversions from degree minute seconds to decimal degrees, which is simply applying a formula we all know, to a very complicated formula when we are changing, for example, from UTM to decimal degree. We miss the title, we miss the UTM zone, whatever. We might end up with inaccurate geospatial information. At the time of digitization, there are several issues that also can appear. These are some of them that are relevant. For example, we can change the order of the coordinates, the longitude first and the latitude last. Or we can ignore or forget about the minus sign. We are working with south or west hemispheres. We can also use different symbols as decimal separators. Or any other issue that might introduce inaccuracies in our geospatial information. There are some methods that might reduce precision in order to gain accuracy. We made the geospatial information, the coordinates, vague enough to pick both our inaccurate value and the right value, possible right value. That might be seen as an improvement of the quality of the data. Range of possible uses is narrower, but still useful at certain points. Now, what about the taxonomic data? What is the precision applied to the taxonomic data? Precision here is seen as the completion of higher taxonomic levels. The more levels we have, the more precise our taxonomic information will be. In fact, the precision depends on the lowest taxonomic rank that has any kind of information. If our lowest level of information is the genus, then that's a fairly precise set of taxonomic information. That's a fairly precise record. And it might be useful for a broader range of possible uses. If our lowest level is class, that's not a very precise taxonomic information. We might not be able to use it for many purposes, just for the most high level of assessments. And the threshold of acceptability, in fact, depends on several factors. Among them, the two most important are the scope of the analysis and the taxonomy. Depending on the analysis we want to do, a more or less precise taxonomy information will be enough or not. It really depends on what we want to do. Now, taxonomic data accuracy, or lack of accuracy in taxonomic data may be due to one of these two, maybe. But these two cases, the use of a wrong taxonomy, or inaccuracies when identifying the organism and applying a taxonomy. We will speak further and deeper about the use of wrong taxonomies in another section of this workshop, the taxonomy assessments. But a couple of ideas that taxonomic hierarchies are subjective because they depend on the point of view of the expert taxonomist. And thus, there are different taxonomies, there are different ways of organizing the organisms and classifying them. So if we don't have enough levels of information, how can we know how to rely on a taxonomic identification? Say, for example, ammonites, we have the same name, that's applied to different organisms. How describe that name, or what is the taxonomy classification for that name? As I said, we're going to see this in the taxonomy assessment sessions. We're going to focus now on the second one, which is the wrong identification of organisms. That can be due to a lack of expertise or to a bad identification environment. In order to have reliable taxonomic identification, we must have expert curation at some point. We need an expert to come see our identification list and say, okay, this is good, this is a good identification of this organism. If we have inaccurate taxonomic identifications, we can use tools such as the annotations tools as error flagging, making predictions, do not prevent these issues, but greatly help in its resolution. It could greatly help in improving the reliability of the next identification. And what do I mean by a bad identification environment? As I said before, there are several types of primary biodiversity data, there are several types of occurrences, and each one of them has associated a different level of reliability. Museum specimens are preserved over time, so they can be reviewed. We have identification of a specimen. We don't know if it's well done, so we call an expert. Expert comes, see the organism, and says, yes, this identification is right. What happens with field observations? There's no physical record. We don't have the organism we've seen, so it cannot be reviewed. The only way to assess the reliability is to get an idea of the expertise of the person that made that identification. If the scientist or the researcher is an expert on that, that's going to be good. That identification is more reliable than one made by, for example, citizen science. Let's move on to the temporal data and see what do I mean by precision in temporal data. Here again, the precision in a date depends on the degree of completion of that date. The more automated that, the more precise it will be. But that we call standard recommends using this encoding schema, ISO 8601. Which allows for a wide range of different data formats. The canonical, the ideal way of representing a date is using this 4-digit year, 2-digit month, 2-digit day, in that order, written like that. But the encoding scheme allows for what they call reduced precision formats, which can be dates that are only shown as year and month, or a year with 4 digits, or a year with 2 digits, or even centuries with 2 digits. So there are a series of issues with these reduced formats. Like, for example, what's the usability of a low precision date? Let's suppose we have as all the temporal information that occurrence happening in the 19th century. To what extent is that information usable? And besides, there are some ambiguity issues with this reduced format also. Let's say we have 90 in our data paper. What does that mean? It's a day. A month is not possible, but it's year 1919, or 19th century, or not now. When we reach year 2020, will it be 2019? We're not really sure. So the solution here to deal with these dates relies on the development of solid date parcels, solid programs that interpret these dates, split them into pieces and say, okay, this is the year, this is the month, this is the date. Or human interpretation at some point. Humans are better in interpreting implicit data that's not there. You can imagine what that means. Computers cannot. Downside is that the parcels are hard to build. We humans get overwhelmed too easily. We have more than 100 records, so we get tired of this. And the accuracy of temporal data, or in fact the inaccuracies in temporal data, can have several aspects. One of the most common is the yellow and swap, which is putting information in the wrong field, such as putting the date in the month field or the month in the day field. So sometimes these issues are self-detectable. For example, with this date here, it's obvious that this 19 is not a month. It can be a month with a number higher than 12. But other times it's not so evident. We have 2012-06-03. Which one is day and which one is month? We're not really sure. So the best solution in this case is to go back to the original data, check the original value, and say, okay, the stored value is right, or the stored value is wrong. Another source of inaccuracies in temporal data are misspellings. It can be the removal of certain figure in a date. It can be the change in any of the figures of a date. That can introduce these inaccuracies, can make this data wrong if the date is wrong. So again, here the best solution is to go back to the original data, check which is the right value, and update it if needed. So the general implications of having low precision and low accuracy in general with primary biodiversity data is that the low precision reduces the range of possible uses. Still, low precision data is usable to a certain extent. For example, low precision coordinates can be used for regional or national checklists, or having only the country value, having just country as a geospatial information, can still be used for national checklists. Low precision taxonomic data can be used in large group assessments, and low precision date information can be used in large scale assessments such as climate change. We don't need to know for climate change analysis the specific moment of the year, the specific date. But still, some minimum precision is required to the data that we use at all. Low accuracy is hard to deal with because it can lead to wrong conclusions. And a way of getting out of it is to reduce the precision so that the inaccuracies are masked. Inaccuracies by themselves can be hard to spot, as example with the date, which is ambiguous. But recently there has been some movement in the scientific field that says that merging, putting together good and bad information can help in detecting issues and detecting problems. We will see this with an example. Let's imagine we have a collection of records, and all the records but one have the year between 1995 and 1998, and there's one record that has the declared year 1986. If it's just one record in the whole collection, it's very likely that the good value, the original value, is 1996. But if we only take the 1986 by itself, we're not really sure if that is right or wrong. So there's a hot discussion on the topic. It's better to show, to publish wrong data in order to allow these relations to detect them. So, quick set of conclusions. A little data is better than no data. Still allows for most basic usability of information. And while the absence of data could be seen as better than having wrong data, this last example we've seen that this wrong data together with good data can help in detecting errors and improving.